The book of Luke, chapter number 14. The book of Luke, chapter number 14. We said we were going to deal with verses 1 through 11 this morning. We only dealt with verse 2. And verse 4. Let's see which way the Lord will lead us this afternoon. Luke 14:1. And it came to pass, as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day, that they watched him. Focusing your eyes on the Lord is a good thing, but those who focus their eyes upon Christ for their harm is an evil thing. Proverbs 23 and verse number 7 says, Proverbs 23 and verse number 7, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. He's not what he looks like on the outside. God looks on the heart. What he is in his heart, that's what he really is. Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. The chief Pharisee said, eat and drink, but his heart was not with him. Psalm 37 in verse 32. Psalm 37 and verse 32. The wicked watcheth the righteous and seeketh to slay him. Isaiah 29. And verse number 20. Isaiah 29 and verse number 20. For the terrible one is brought to naught, and the scorner is consumed, and all they that watch for iniquity are cut off. They're the ones that make a man an offender for a word, and lay a snare for him that reproveth in the gate, and turneth aside the just for a thing of naught. It came to pass, it could not have come to pass unless eternally decreed of God. It could not come to pass except it was predestinated and according to God's purposes in Christ Jesus, Ephesians 1:11. But it did come to pass, and it would come to pass in the house of this Pharisee. I wonder if we could go yonder to the depths of the damned and speak to him, if he had any sound mind at all, and ask him, do you regret having your house used to try to trap the Son of God so that you might, in your own mind, justify your murder of him? I'm sure he would say no. And behold, there was a certain man before him which had the dropsy. I think these words before him are just marvelous. I wonder how did he get before him? I wonder when Ms. Chief Pharisee put the little folded cards down with the names on them, the place where folks were to sit, if she provided a place for Christ with an empty chair where this man sat down, or did it just fall out by chance? You know I don't believe that. There was a certain man before him which had the dropsy. And Jesus answering spake unto the lawyers and Pharisees, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And they held their peace, because they were not about the law, They were about trying to exalt themselves. And the spiritual man is always going to be crucified by the religious boys. And they held their peace, and he took him and healed him and let him go. And answered them, saying, which of you shall have an ass or an ox fallen into a pit, and will not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? You won't even think about it twice. You'll straightway get him out. And again, they could not answer him again to these things. They could not answer him again. Second time, he put them to silence. And he put forth a parable to those which were bidden. When he marked how they chose out the chief rooms, chief places, the chief spaces, saying unto them, when thou art bidden of any man to a wedding, sit not down to in the highest place, the highest room, lest a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him. And he that bade thee and him come and say to thee, give this man place, and thou begin with shame to take the lowest room. The words place and room are used interchangeable. It's not talking about a separate room of the house. And when thou art bidden, but when thou art bidden, do you think the Lord obeyed his own word? It says that it came to pass as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day. Was Christ bidden to come to that meal on the Sabbath day by the Pharisee? Yep. Here's the rule out of his mouth. You think he obeyed it? But when thou art bidden, go and sit down in the lowest place, that when he that bade thee cometh, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher. Then shalt thou have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. For whosoever, does that include Christ, exalteth himself shall be abased. And he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. In verse number 10, the apex of all activity among humankind. Humankind who was made in the image of God. The greatest thing that they can do is bring that image back to God in a regenerate state that God has given them, developing it, cooperating with the cross in mortification to die to self, cooperation with the Holy Spirit in exaltation, that they might rise up, O men of God, and have done with earthly things, and may sit up in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, in order that in bringing this image that we have been given to die more to self and be made more and more alive unto Christ, that it might bring pure glory and worship to the Lord Jesus Christ. Friend, go up. Friend, go up higher. Then shalt thou have worship. And the 24 beasts, they cast their crowns at his feet and they worshiped him. What is worship? It is not simply lip service in ascribing to God the glory that is his. It includes that. But it is a heart that desires God to be everything, even if yourself has to be no thing. Amen. Friend, go up higher. Why should you go up higher? Because you have taken the lowest room or the lowest place. Where did that place put you? It put you with the man with the dropsy before him. There was no Pharisee sitting anywhere close to him. You see his shape. You see his form. He's having a hard time breathing. He is in a mess. He wobbles when he walks, staggers around. Not the kind of feller you want to you know, anybody even know you thought you wanted to be a friend with, because Pharisaism is all about appearance and looking on the outward appearance. But here is one that went down to the lowest place, and therefore across from him, without a name place, was the man with the dropsy. He got a condition wherein his heart and his kidneys are not working. He has a blood issue. It is something that men may try to control and try to keep it on an even keel if they can, but only God can heal. And yet, God would have this man. I don't know how old he was. I don't know what his occupation was. I don't know what involvement his family had or did not have with him. But here he was, and forever how many years God had purposed, and ever how he got there to the Pharisee's house, I don't know. But it was in the purpose and mind of God to strike this man with the dropsy in order that he might sit right across from Jesus. I wonder about praying for everybody that they might be healed if we're not taking them out of the presence of God sometimes. I don't know how to pray for them. I do pray for all of them. But I pray thy will be done, because I don't want them to go to hell in a good physical condition. So the man had a disease. It was taking him down. It took his manly strength. It probably took him away from his job. He had to be careful getting out of bed. He had to be careful standing up fast out of a chair. It was congestive heart failure with kidney failure. That's what it was, dropsy. But it put him in a place to where there was one religious man, one, just one, that would come down to the end of the table where he was. He's going to the end of the table, the man with the dropsy. Ain't no doubt about it. You ain't sitting up here with us Pharisees. You wasn't even invited. And yet, the eternal Son of God, chief prince of heaven, the Alpha. Nobody else anywhere close to him. He's the Alpha. Seraphim, what are they? I don't know. Cherubim, explain that to me. Bow down and worship him. Created beings stand in his presence and have to shield their faces with their wings, because even though they're created to stand in the presence of his glory, there's so much difference between creator and creation that that can't be born without shielding. That one comes in the Pharisee's house. He's not going to have anything for lunch that day unless he gets invited. He's not going by the steakhouse. They didn't have, evidently, steakhouses like we do today. He don't have a place to lay his head, but that fox Herod does. He has no nest to rest his fluttering wings like the birds of the air. And he's not going to have any lunch today except an old stinking Pharisee invite him home with him. He calmly comes in. There is no beauty about him that we should desire him. And they're going to have to pay a man some pieces of silver in order to get somebody to identify him, because he's such an ordinary looking guy. And he comes in without fanfare. There are no angels to blow the golden trumpets and proclaim the eternal Son of God. He just comes in without notice and walks down to the far end of the table. Everybody else is looking on the outward appearance. He's looking on the heart. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 26. For ye see, two words, please. Who's calling? Your calling. Wait a minute now. All right, let's get that straight first. Who is your? All the elect of God, right? Everybody that's been chosen in Him from the foundation of the world. That next word now, that calling, is it like you calling your son 15 times and he ain't come towards you yet? It's the effectual call of the power of God calling you to Him in His grace without you being able to resist it. Okay? This is sovereignty right here. For you see, you that are elected, being called effectually brethren. All right, look among you. Look among you. What do you see? Well, we are a motley crew. What do you see? Well, I'll tell you what I don't see. Not many wise men after the flesh. That's the Pharisees. Not many mighty. Not many noble are called. So Jesus comes walking into the house, and He knows that all those that shall be in Him in eternity, with Him in eternity, were chosen in Him from eternity past. Can I say that? You know what I'm trying to say. It's hard to preach on eternity without saying past and present and future and all that. And so He sees a brother. You see your calling, brethren. And He sees one that He didn't assign to be outstanding in his might or his nobility. He didn't even determine that he would even be normal in his health. But God hath chosen. Not the Pharisees, they won't sit with him. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the Pharisees. God hath chosen the man with the dropsy to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things. Wish he'd quit bouncing up against my walls. You're going to get my walls dirty. The weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. You don't realize what a blessing it is to walk down a hall and not bounce off each wall. And base things of the world. When you was a kid and they chose upsides to play baseball, was you the last one they ever chose? Don't answer that. The base things of the world and things which are despised, get him out of here. Hath God chosen. Wow. God came walking in that house that day. His stomach was growling. He had a stomach. All points tempted. I thirst, he said on the cross. Being weary with his journey, he said, sitting on the well in John 4. He was hungry that day. And he came walking in and saw one that he had determined to be there, that God had chosen. He was not looking for physical bread for himself. He was looking for this dear brother to eat himself, eat Christ. He was not looking for bread to eat for himself. He was looking to be bread for this brother. And things which are not. Did you know some people are invisible? Oh yeah, you've seen that movie, The Invisible, but no, I ain't talking about that. Some people are so caught up with their self, they can't see anybody else. And that's what this guy was. But God could see him. Isn't that good? You sang a lot today about the shepherd, didn't you? He said, I know my sheep. And I call them by their name. And why did he choose all of this? Verse 28. In order to bring to nothing things that are. Now, are they really things that are? No, they're just things that the world and themselves consider to be important. He's going to bring them to nothing. Why? In order that no flesh should glory in his presence. The atmosphere reeked of self-importance and vainglory, self-righteousness and self-centeredness. God would sit upon his throne across from a thing that was naught, a thing that was base, a thing that while Christ died for him, he was ungodly, a thing that had no money to pay him. There was no reason for God to heal him of himself. He didn't warrant it. He didn't deserve it. He couldn't do nothing good for God in order to get it. It's just that God would be God, and God is love, and love cannot be except it gives. The expression of love is given. For God so loved, he gave. And his is the most blessed part, for it is more blessed to give than to receive. He wasn't there to receive from the Pharisees' table. I'm sure he ate, but that wasn't the reason he was there, for himself. It was the reason for the social event, whatever you want to call it, taking place. But the purpose behind it all was an eternal Savior, a lamb slain from the foundation of the world, had determined the times before appointed in the bounds of that habitation of that one man, had to give him the dropsy in order to get him there at that particular time, at that particular place, that he might find the Lord. And so he did. But in finding the Lord, you really are found of the Lord. Finish this sentence. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. He what be found? What's that word? May. Isn't may a term of permission? Teacher, can I go to the bathroom? You may if you can. I don't know if you got the ability to or not. That's can, but you have my permission. Dear soul, if you ain't got God's permission, you ain't going to find him. And this is where God would be found of him. And yet, the Savior, in order to come to where that man was, had to take the lowest place in the dining room. You remember them two words in verse 2 that we kept on harping on this morning? Behold, there was a certain man where? Before him. I don't think that just means physically sitting across the table. I think it means God had a consciousness of this is the place where the man would be saved. But I don't think you can exclude it from it being in reference to the man sitting there in his presence across from him at the table. Because he couldn't take him and heal him and let him go if he wasn't before him. And if he was before him, it was Jesus that had to position himself, had to position Jesus in the presence of the man, because the man was never going to get to Jesus if he was going to be Mr. Snooty like the rest of the self-righteous boys and sit down there and talk to him about Dr. Bottlestopper. Dear soul, listen, you ever heard that verse? You ever heard those words about God condescending to men of low estate? Have you ever heard of that? Was you all squeaky clean and, you know, nice and smell good and, you know, as far as your your spiritual man was concerned and all fragrant and really enticing to God when he saved you? You can say that about yourself. I ain't going to say it about me. I wasn't. Bible said from the crown of my head to the sole of my foot, I was a putrefying soul. Wretched and undone. Without hope and without God in the world. God came to where I was. Because I didn't know who he was or where to find him. But bless God, he found me. And you know what that did? It's put worship in my heart. That you might have worship. That no flesh should glory in your presence. Because I know God found me. I was wretched and undone without God or his son. God came where I was. And so, dear soul, the Lord Jesus Christ is going down there when he's bidden to come to the man's house and sit down at the lowest place. And it's going to cause him to be worshiped. God will be worshiped by those who have been found by the Lord Jesus Christ. God will be worshiped by a redeemed gang of that have been overcome by the grace of Almighty God. These that have come out of great tribulation, and these that have washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb, those and only those will bring worship to him. And he is the one that came and sat where they sat. If you want to look, Matthew 11 and verse number 5. John sends two of his disciples to Christ. You know, I guess he's allowed a phone call out of the jail. And he calls and says, you boys go over there and ask that Jesus of Nazareth if he is the Messiah. Or are we supposed to be looking for somebody else? Do you know the answer he gave him? Jesus answered and said unto them, Matthew 11, 4, go and show John again. The doves already told him. Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. Listen, here it is. This is how you know I'm the Messiah. The blind, the lame, the lepers, the deaf, the dead, the poor. That's your resume? That's what you're going to put out? That's what you're associated with? Don't sound like much of a savior to me. Yes, it does if you know God. This is the Lord Jesus taking the lowest place, and therefore he winds up sitting across from the man who is before him, and he's the only one God came to heal. He didn't have anything for the Pharisees, because Christ only came to die for sinners. Verse 6, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Dear friend, if you're only for those who can bring you earthly glory, then you would be offended in Christ. Listen at this, John 11 and verse 28. I quote this a lot to people. Mary and Martha are weeping because Jesus has waited some few days, stayed where he was 2 days in verse 6 of chapter 11 of John. And they're deliberating with the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes. Martha first, and then we find something in verse number 28. And this verse has helped me, and I hope it's helped those that I quoted it to in their circumstance, in their situation. John 11, 28, and when she had so said, when Martha got through talking to him, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, You read it. You get the blessing. What is it? What did she say to her?
The master is come and calleth for thee.
That's what the Holy Spirit said that boy with the dropsy. You're in a Pharisee's house. Ooh, you better watch out. They'll throw you out as unclean. There's something different here. What is it? Who is that with those eyes of fire sitting across from you? Who is that whose gaze is affixed upon you? How come you are like that feller at the gate, beautiful, and you fix your eyes on him expecting to receive something from him? What is there about your heart that is now excited, and about your soul and your mind, and expectation fills your being? Because the master is come and calleth for thee. It's not about the woman of the house. It's not about the chief Pharisee. It's not about all the rest of the Pharisees. It's not about anybody else in that house. It's just you and God. The master is come and calleth for thee. Isn't that amazing? Whatever God has to do, I want you to know something. Listen to me. There will not be one single soul of God's election that fails to come to redemption and glorification. Not a one. For whom he called, for whom he foreknew, they also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. Same them. Not you can't add one more to it, and you can't take one away from it. Every single soul that God has elected will be brought in to the presence of his eternal glory. And if Jesus has to enter a Pharisee's house and take the lowest room in order to ensure that he will sit across from you, and having given you the dropsy in order that you have pressed yourself into this man's hospitality, that I'm talking about the Pharisee, this man's hospitality who did not invite you, then he will do it because he's going to bring in his elect sheep without the loss of one. Ain't God good? Luke 23, there is an amazing account. Luke 23 and verse 32. If you were ever going to come to the place in time and in history that is the most pregnant day to fulfill all past prophecies and to bring forth all future works and acts of God, it would be to have been there at the cross where the Prince of Glory died. Well might the sun refuse to shine and shut its glories in when Christ the mighty maker died for man, the creature's sin. And there was one of God's elect people that he had determined that they would actually be involved in experiencing the same kind of death physically on the same day by the same hands in the same place. And in Luke 23 and verse 32, and there were also two other malefactors, evildoers, led with him to be put to death. And when they, Christ and the malefactors, were come to the place which is called Calvary, listen, there they crucified him, comma, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Hold your place. Look at Matthew 27 and verse 44. We're coming right back to Luke 23. Don't lose your place. Matthew 27. And verse 44. In verse 43, they're mocking him and saying, if he's God, let him deliver himself. Would you read me verse 44 of Matthew 27, please?
The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth.
Is that second word in verse 44 plural or singular?
Plural.
How many thieves were there? How many of them cast the same in their teeth?
All
two of them. All right, let's go back. Luke 23. Luke 23, verse 39. And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. Read me the first three words of verse 40. Now, in your Matthew 27, 44, you said that word, that second word was singular or plural?
Plural.
So both of them was railing on him. Now, the first word in verse number 40 of Luke 23 is but. That's a word of contradiction, isn't it? But the other, they're separated now. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? Listen, here's repentance. And we indeed justly. If you don't believe that you are justly condemned, you never have been granted repentance. If you keep on saying them, they, and all, as long as you don't say me, you ain't got it. And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. Listen, here's the other half of repentance. But this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, next word,
Lord,
remember me. Do you love me, Peter? Honey, did you think about me while you were gone on that trip you had to take? Was I ever on your mind? Do you really love me? What does he say? Remember, think about me. Focus your eyes upon me. Consider me. Salvation is a personal thing, wherein God Almighty comes close to thee. Remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, adds a word of assurance. Verily, that word is truly, that word is surely. Listen, I say unto thee today, shalt thou be, two words,
with me.
And it don't matter where it is, but what will it be, the rest of the sentence? It's going to be paradise. Well, honey, I ain't got much money, but we're just going to have to live in a very modest home. And we won't be able to, you know, have a lot of extra. She puts her hand on his mouth. Hush. As long as I got you, I got all I want. Is that love or what? If that ain't the way it is, she's a gold digger. Right? The harlot church are gold diggers. Their name is Jimmy. They'll take all you give me. But the true church is just happy to be with Jesus. Amen? Come on now.
Amen. That's right.
And so he said, remember me. And wherever that is, Jesus said, being with me will be paradise. One man has to stumble and fall, gasp for breath, look swollen and obvious something's wrong about him, and crash the party and come in where he's not been invited. And Jesus comes and sits across from him. He takes the lowest place at the dinner party. And the man winds up before him, and because of his dropsy, Jesus heals him and lets him go, excusing him from the contention that's fixing to follow, where precious spiritual truth deals with legalistic, self-centered Pharisees. What a glorious Savior. But another man, a thief. There ain't nothing worse than a thief. I hate thieves. You ever had your house broken in? I've had my car broken in. I've had my house broken in. Listen, it's awful. You don't even want to lay down at night when the door's busted all to pieces. You say, people that meant me evil have been in my bedroom. But that's what Jesus ordained this man to be in order to wind up with such a crime that they put him in the same place with his cross. Are you such a sinner that you've wound up in the place where one is going to have all the sin of all the church for all the world put on him? He's the offscouring of the earth. What about you? We esteemed him smitten of God. No man could get all this judgment on him unless God was against him. What about you? Were you stricken of God? We hid, as it were, our faces from him. What about you? Were you despised and rejected of men? Have you ever come to be so low that that's where you ran into Jesus? There was one that had the dropsy. There was one that had an executive order from the Roman government to execute him in the same place, on the same day, in the same method as Jesus Christ. Glory to God. It's my sin. Listen, that did abound in order that grace may reign and grace may more abound. If you ain't a sinner, you ain't going to get no grace. But if you're a sinner, come on in with the rest of us and Jesus will get worship, friend. But you're going to have to come on down here to the end of the table with us bums. That's all that God ever calls. Ain't God good? Folk, let me ask you this. How can you get Joseph out of Potiphar's house into Pharaoh's throne? How in the world are you going to get Joseph, who don't have an agent except the Holy Ghost? He don't have anybody shooting for him. In fact, he didn't get a letter of recommendation from Potiphar. How in the world do you get him from Potiphar's house onto the throne of Pharaoh? A slanderous, lying woman. Oh, it's me, you say. Everything's against me. Not God. Do you know that God can take a crooked stick and draw a straight line? You ain't seen the end of this yet. But you don't know what they said about me. It ain't nothing compared to what you said about Jesus before he saved you. Hello. We don't believe that God's ways are higher than our ways. We used to sing about it. God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. Somebody's standing on the clouds and riding on the storm, you know. You ain't seen all of it yet. The just shall live by
faith.
And faith evidences things not seen. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. That's what the spiritual man's supposed to do. How'd you get back over there in the methods of the physical and the worldly man? Get back in there where God put you and believe God. Has he ever done anything wrong to anybody ever? No. And did not he tell you, Mr. John Brown Calvinist, that everything he has to happen to you will work together for your good? You know what my problem is and yours is? You ain't waiting till it gets all worked together yet. Our time's gone. 2 Corinthians 6. I want to go to the most experienced brother other than Jesus Christ that I know. He is my boss. He is one of the 12 apostles. I'm not allowed to say anything that he did not pin down, that the apostles did not bring forth. They are the foundation of the church, and I've got to stay on it. So I want to go to the apostle to the Gentiles, me being one, and listen to what he says the ministry is like. And dear soul, apply this to your own heart as a Christian. 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 4. But in how many things are we to approve ourselves? But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God. Now listen at this list. You may not like some of it. Let me just read it like this. But in all things, approving ourselves as the ministers of God, whether it be dropsy or getting slandered by Potiphar's wife. You get where I'm headed? All right, now listen. In much patience, you may have had a little eyedropper drop full of patience. You're going to have a wash bucket full before it's over with. In much patience. In afflictions. What? In necessities. That means I don't get what I need. Not just that you don't get what you want. In necessities. I need that, but God won't give it to me. In distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by longsuffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unmolded, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left. Listen, by honor, you read me the next two words. Uh-oh. You're going to be lied on and misrepresented. But that's included in approving yourselves. Listen. Listen. And by evil report as well as good report. Just so you can wear it as a badge of courage. I'm hated, lied on, and slandered. Good. You must be walking with Jesus. Right? Ain't nobody saying amen. You don't hear this, do you? All right, let me get on through it. As deceivers. Better stay away from him. He's a deceiver. But you know that you're true. As unknown and yet well known. As dying and behold we live. As chastened and not killed. As sorrowful yet always rejoicing. As poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing all things. What is your greatest possession, Christian? Christ. Sitting across the table for Jesus. Is it your house? Jesus. No. Was you invited? No. Did they pass the bread to you? No. Are they going to ask you to stay for coffee and cake? No. But who are you sitting across from? The Holy Son of God. You just wait. The last, down yonder at the end of the table, especially that and sitting there with those eyes of fire, are going to be made first. And those that sitting up at the head of the table, the first, last.